Hey everyone, Eric here. And today we're going beyond SketchUp Desktop so that I can share with you 5 quick tips for achieving more realistic renders using SketchUp and V-Ray. Okay, so I get this question a lot in the forum, in the community forums, basically saying, hey, how's my rendering? I'm just learning, but it's not looking realistic. And I want to say, well, hey, just because you're using V-Ray, which is one of the more realistic results, it's a ray tracer, right? It's the industry standard. You should be able to achieve the best results if you know how to use it. So I don't want to teach you all V-Ray in 10 minutes. We've got a course for that. I'm going to plug it at the end. But I do want to share with you a few things that you should be thinking about if you're not already. So let's just get into it. I've got my model here. I've done a little bit of work already to kind of get this in shape, but I'm going to take a step back because my first thing that I wanted to share with you is this idea of geometry. So I'm going to talk about corners for a second. So let's go ahead and zoom in here, and I want to double check this setting in my material. Again, don't worry about the details here because I cover all of this in another lesson. In more detail. But I do want you to think about this idea of when you render in SketchUp, when we model, we have 90 degree angles. But in real life, nothing's going to be 90 degrees. Even things that should be 90 degrees will have this tiny little bevel or a chamfer. Now, you can use an extension like Bevel by MindSight or Fredo Corner, for example. Those are two great ones. Or you can come in and actually add a bevel to the material. Let me show you what I mean. Let's first see what it looks like without. I'm going to press interactive render, and I'm going to zoom in sort of on this corner here, on this left corner of this kitchen cabinet. So you can see this is a 90 degree angle, and there's nothing wrong with that. It looks sort of less realistic. Maybe we can also see it here if we zoom in on this corner. It almost disappears completely because of the way the shadow angle shows. So what we can do is we can add a bump map and we can change it to what's called local space bump map. And under that bump map settings, make sure that we choose corners or edges as its base parameter. So that's basically as its base input. So you don't need to know all that, but I do want you to look at the difference. Let's zoom back in again. And you can see, do you see that kind of light that's hitting the edge? So if I turn that local space bump, if I turn that corner off, you can see I just get this sharp corner. And that's not really realistic because it's not reflecting light realistically. And if I switch back and I'm basically, this is a trick. I'm using a material setting in V-Ray to basically force it to have corners or make it look like it's got a round corner when in actuality, of course, it doesn't. So again, I'm just going to kind of rotate around to this corner. You can see if I zoom in really close, I get the appearance of these round corners. And I know that that's a subtle effect, but just having that light being able to hit those corners, again, it's going to give a subtle realism. If I turn that off, bump map, you can see super sharp, little blocky, little cartoony, little video gamey. Turn those rounded corners on, looks much better. So I'm going to stop there. That's my first one. It's geometry. Get that geometry. You don't even have to model it. Just make it look like it's got more detail than it actually does. So let's pop back over here into my kind of almost more completed render. And I want to look at my number two thing, which is lighting. So if I pull up my handy frame buffer here, then you can see just how important lighting is for realism. Now, I've went ahead and turned off the materials for this because I wanted to look at the lights effect on my model. So I'm going to load this one here and you can see the difference. Maybe it helps if I do what's called AB. So if I set this as an A and I set this as a B, what you can do is you can sort of scrub between two different ones and you can even zoom in and you can look really closely and say, okay, how might the light affect the stuff that's in the background? Things that maybe don't feel that important because it's not the hero of the model, so to speak. But you can see whether you have sort of a bright washed light or whether you have a subtle light coming in from the windows. The lighting makes a huge difference. Now you could also see not just the lighting coming in from the exterior for interiors, or of course, if you're doing an exterior, the lighting in the exterior, the HDRI is really important, but also these, you can also look to see how artificial lighting changes kind of the look and feel of your model. There's this cool thing you can do. It's a layer, it's under here, under channels, and it's called LightMix. So I like to render with LightMix because LightMix allows me to go back in after the rendering is done, and I can go in and turn off certain things. For example, I'm going to get rid of my AB, and I wanna load just this one to my VFB. Look at my LightMix, and I can see that I've got these can lights. I can turn those off. I've got a pendant light. It's subtle, but I can see how that affects it. I can turn my sunlight off. And then of course I do have a dome light in there. I brought in a rectangle light. So you can see how both the combination of sunlight, dome lights, mesh lights, pendant lights, and then of course if you need a wash or a fill light, to give more ambient lighting. Each one of those all comes together to create sort of the end result and mood that you're looking for. And with light mix, if it's a little too bright, it's kind of cool. Even after the rendering's done, I can pull that back, say by 75%, or maybe even 50%, like I want that ambient light, but maybe not so much. Again, if you haven't already used it in the under your lights toolbar here, there's this great tool called LightGen. And LightGen will let you load any of many, many, many different options as HDRI lighting. So you can just drop it in as a dome light and you can just do a quick render and you can see again just how that lighting changes the mood or changes sort of the realism. Again, the realism is how light bounces, where it's coming from, how it transitions, etc. So that's my number two. I want to go look at materials. So let's pop over here to, let's take a little close up at something on the counter. I've got a few different materials going on, the sink, the faucet, you know, the furnishings or sort of the entourage, like the soap dispenser. So let me go ahead and load this rendering to the VFB. So if you zoom in really closely, you can see that the reflections on the different materials have different properties. For example, the marble is fairly highly reflective, but the glossiness has come down. If it's glass, it's transparent. So you have both reflection and refraction, which is something different than if you have a diffuse texture. So again, these are all fancy terms. You don't have to know all of them. The point is that you need good materials to get good reflections or to get good details. It means they gotta be high quality. They have to have the right settings. If you try to make all these from scratch, it could be challenging. If you pop over here to Cosmos, which is in your V-Ray toolbar, and you can go to Cosmos Home, and you can find materials, like for example, if I'm looking for something like copper or bronze, you can see I've got quite a few different materials to choose from, and I can look at this, and I can kind of get a sense of, is this going to work for me? If so, I'm going to download it, and I'm going to import that to my model, and I'll run a test render, and I'll say, hey, that looks great. Or maybe I'll do that in a model off to the side. I'll run three different coppers. And if I like one, I'll say, okay, that's the one I want. Let's bring this into my model now. So again, V-Ray Cosmos has great materials for you. They've got all of these sort of predetermined settings like reflection and bump and normal or displacement. They're all built in. So you don't have to do a ton of work looking for them online or creating them from scratch, in which case could be, it might be the right thing if you have a really specific material, but a lot of times we can get by with the ones that come with Cosmos. So that is Cosmos. And while we're on Cosmos, I want to go to my number four thing. So let me pop actually out of Cosmos for 1 second. We're going to pop right back into it. If I load this rendering here, my last one, to the VFB, I have here, and let me check my exposure settings. I might want to brighten that up a little bit, maybe knock my highlight burn down. And let's zoom in. You can see I've got just these pears that are sitting on my counter. And I also have these flowers that are sitting on my counter and the vases that they sit within. You can see that these, it's not faceted, so you can't see any edges that make up the round bowl. Or the round vase, which means that these are high poly assets. And same thing with the pears. You can see they're very smooth, they're very detailed, the texture looks really good. And that's because I have two different assets. One came from the 3D warehouse and one came from Cosmos. So if you do look for the 3D warehouse one, let's just scroll over here, you'll notice the difference here. If you get something from 3D warehouse, you're probably going to get very high poly. You can see that I've got very high poly vegetation because high poly means realism, right? But in 3D, but you got to be careful that then your model doesn't get bogged down. So if you have lots and lots and lots of really high poly assets to get that level of detail that you want, you of course could have a trade-off of performance later. So there's some good looking assets that I got from both 3D warehouse, but also this one here is actually two assets. I got a fruit bowl, but I liked this other bowl better. So I kind of put the fruit bowl inside of the other bowl. And the reason why I can't separate them, I can't just go in and grab this, it's because it's a proxy. So this whole mesh is actually being loaded from outside of SketchUp. So I'm kind of stuck with the bowl that the fruit came in. I'll give you an example. If you come over here to Cosmos again, and you can look at 3D models as a category instead of materials, and you can find under here, I'm just going to type in fruit and just see what comes up. And if I'm lucky, I will find, here's one. I'm just going to download this one, even though I've already got fruit in my model. Hey, who doesn't like fruit? I'm going to pop this in, and you can see what it does is it comes in as sort of a low poly representation of that object. And it is like that because it is meant to keep your model lightweight. But if I went and pressed render, for example, and I probably won't let this whole thing render, it might take a couple minutes, but I just want you to see really quick. If I just press render on that, you get the full detailed, here, let me do this. I'm just going to do a render region. No, I'll just let it go. You get all the detail from that fruit bowl, but you don't have to load all the polygons and the textures and the settings and all of that stuff that goes along with it. That's actually loaded from outside of SketchUp. So again, your assets that you choose, not just, let me stop that. I think you get the point. Not just the assets that you choose as far as the level of detail, but also, again, do they fit the mood and the theme? This bowl didn't fit. So I went ahead and placed it inside of another bowl that I felt would be better with like my rustic farmhouse feel. And then also just putting things in, like not making everything perfect. You know, if you've got to rotate something, you know, if you have a book and it's tilted and then you have a spoon sitting out, this idea of adding entourage, but adding a little bit of variability to it. So you can see I've got, you know, a mug sitting inside of, I've got these mugs, but they're not exactly lined up perfectly. And same thing, you know, just having a little bit of scale and a little bit of placement variety so it doesn't look so perfect. Let me pop back to my view here. So that's number four, entourage. Let me go to number five. I want to finish up by saying the fifth quick thing you can do for realism, and I see this all the time on the forum, is your output size. So by output size, I mean there's two different ways to get high quality render output. And one of that is what's called quality. So you can pull your quality slider all the way up to the max, which is high plus. Problem with that is that it's going to take a little while to, it's got more, you know, detail in it. That's good. But that means it's going to take a little longer to render. So the second thing you can do is look at the render output in the image width and basically the height. So if you wanted to put something like 10,000 pixels, which would probably take a little while to render, probably take a couple hours, that's pretty large. And that would be awesome. So what I would do is I would balance the pixels with the quality. For example, if I rendered medium quality and something like 4,000 pixels, I would get a pretty high res image, but I wouldn't be maxing out the amount of time that it takes to render. Because again, after every pixel after a certain point may or may not be noticed. So for me, I try and find the right balance. And I'll give you an example. Let's go ahead and look at this final rendering that I did of this farmhouse. It is not that big in dimensions. It is 2,500 by 1,300. So if I wanted more realism, I would double the number of pixels. But if I go view, actual size, you know, and even if I zoom in a little bit, you can see it still holds up. which is nice. So you can see you've got the lighting from the round corners that I was talking about, that sort of material trick. If I kind of zoom in, you can see that these don't have rounded corners in the actual component. You can see I've got the sort of, they're not all facing the same direction. They're rotated, so you get a little bit of that randomness. You've got the lighting setup, so understanding like where the light sources are coming from and making sure that everything is sort of lit, what I think is realistically and evenly. And then again, just the balancing of the high quality assets that I have here. And so that's basically it, bringing it all together. So let me pause here because, like I said, I was going to throw a bunch of information fairly fast because V-Ray is, these are quick tips, but it's still V-Ray. I will recommend, if you haven't already done, head over to SketchUp Campus, which is learn.sketchup.com, and you can find this same model that I'm demoing with all the tips and tricks, but much slower and much more detailed as we go step by step in our course called V-Ray for Interiors. So if you haven't already done that, check that out. Hopefully you'll find something interesting there that piques your, you know, that sort of boosts your skill set. So I'm going to stop there. I'm going to say thanks for watching. As always, I love V-Ray. I love the challenge. I love learning new things every single day. I know the stuff that I showed you, that's just what I know makes for better realism. And I know that there's even more things that you can do beyond what I'm showing you. But it's a great starting point, just those five things. Again, thinking about edges, lighting, materials, entourage, and your output settings. Just those five things will make a huge difference. And if you don't believe me, go try it yourself. You can come back. If I'm wrong, come back and yell at me in the comments below. Or not, or just say nice things. That's cool too. I will totally take either feedback. So I'll leave you there. I'm going to say thanks for watching as always, and I will see you next time.